Today we're diving into, well, one of the most intellectually provocative results in macroeconomics, the paradox of thrift. The concept posits this fundamental conflict that when individuals, you know, rationally decide to save more, the collective result can actually be a reduction in total saving.
And what's so interesting here is that our source material moves this paradox from just a theoretical idea into verifiable arithmetic. It gives us a step-by-step numerical calculation that shows a definitive result. It shows an intended increase in saving mathematically forces total actual saving to drop from an initial level of 188 units all the way down to 157.
Right. So the central question for us today is this. Is this calculated proof? Is it a truly definitive and robust demonstration of the concept's economic significance? Does it illuminate a necessary failure of coordination in a demand-constrained economy? Or is the dramatic nature of this result largely an artifact, an outcome that's structurally guaranteed by the specific, highly sensitive parameters that define the model's equations?
And I'll be arguing that while the calculation is absolutely sound, the severity of the paradox is, well, it's essentially engineered by the initial assumptions, particularly those governing the multiplier effect. And that really calls into question the generality of this proof beyond this very specific constrained architecture.
And I'll be focusing on the power of this specific model to show how an intended increase in saving leads, mathematically and necessarily, to a lower actual saving level. This confirms the self-defeating logic of the paradox within a structured framework that is highly relevant to periods of, say, economic recession. The mechanism, as confirmed by this calculation, is, well, it's clear and it's unavoidable. When households decide to save more, the marginal propensity to save, the MPS, it goes up. In our model, this means the marginal propensity to consume, the MPC, drops sharply from 0.6 down to 0.5. The instant result is a fall in consumption spending, and that's the initial shock to aggregate demand.
And it's a significant initial shock. It reduces that injection of spending right into the circular flow.
Exactly. And because this is a Keynesian cross model where output is demand determined, that immediate drop in demand kicks off a negative multiplier process. This causes a really sharp decline in the equilibrium output. Why? And this reduction in output then lowers disposable income across the entire economy. It's this erosion of income that ultimately acts as the necessary mechanism forcing the final value of actual saving to go down, even though everyone tried to save more.
And let's just put the numerical consequence of that on the table right away. The calculation shows equilibrium output plunging from 920 units down to, what is it, roughly 714. That's a contraction of over 200 units. It is this catastrophic feedback loop that drives the final saving level down from 188 to 157. So for me, the question isn't the arithmetic. It's why was that collapse so incredibly dramatic?
Well, I see why you'd ask that, but let me offer a different perspective. Let's focus on the economic reality the model is trying to capture here. We started with an economy that was already far below full employment, with a high propensity to consume. So when people suddenly become more thrifty, that kind of contraction is exactly what's predicted in a low-demand environment. The calculation just validates the intensity of that prediction. The logical chain is complete and confirmed. Planned saving went up, actual saving fell.
I'm not sure I agree with that framing. The severity, and really the certainty of the paradox here, is arguably baked right into the starting assumptions about investment behavior. The model we're looking at includes what we call induced investment. That is, investment is defined as I equals 50 plus 0.15y. This 0.15 term, the marginal propensity to invest, or MPI, is the structural element that ensures the initial contraction isn't just large, but amplified.
But that amplification is a standard feature in many realistic macro models. I mean, investment often responds positively to aggregate activity and expectations. If GDP is falling, it makes sense that companies would pull back on new projects. That seems economically sound to me.
I agree that investment is rarely autonomous, but including this positive MPI term structurally guarantees what I call a turbocharged multiplier. When consumption falls, output has to fall. But because investment is tied to output, the fall in output then causes investment to fall even further, which in turn causes output to fall even more dramatically. Without that induced investment, let's say if the investment function were just fixed at I equals 150, regardless of y, the negative multiplier would be far, far less potent.
So are you suggesting the model is unrealistic just because it includes realistic market dependencies? The specific architecture is precisely what allows the paradox to be proven quantitatively. That massive drop in equilibrium output from 920 to 714 is the direct consequence of linking individual decisions, like lower consumption, to collective economic activity, like falling investment.
I'm suggesting the architecture is highly sensitive, not necessarily unrealistic. The debate here is whether this calculation is a robust general proof, or if this just proof that the paradox exists when the negative multiplier is engineered to be as large as possible. If that MPI had been, say, 0.05 instead of 0.15, the drop in Y would have been much smaller. And the final saving level, it might not have dropped from 188 to 157 at all. The calculation, therefore, proves the paradox is really dependent on specific parameter values that guarantee a major contraction.
And that brings us directly to the mechanism itself, to point to the income erosion threshold. I mean, regardless of the parameter sensitivities, the drop in disposable income, Y sub D, is the fundamental economic link. Initially, disposable income was 720. When equilibrium output collapsed to about 714, disposable income dropped substantially. This massive erosion of income is what ultimately decides the fate of actual saving. The model demonstrates that once that initial demand shock happens, the income collapse that follows is so severe that it just overwhelms the individual's higher desire to save, that higher 0.5 MPS.
See, I'm not convinced by that line of reasoning because the core issue for me remains that threshold. For the paradox to hold numerically, the drop in income has to be severe enough to offset the initial increase in the MPS, the fact that every dollar of income is now being saved at a higher rate. If total output had only fallen by, let's say, 50 units instead of 205, that higher MPS might have preserved or even increased actual saving. The paradox would have failed numerically in that scenario.
But it didn't fail. The numerical outcome shows the mechanism successfully crossing that threshold. That is the power of the proof. It confirms that under the conditions defined, specifically where an economy is already below full employment, this self-defeating cycle isn't just possible. It's the mathematically necessary outcome of increasing thrift.
Precisely. The outcome is necessary only because the specific functions for consumption and investment were chosen in such a way that the resulting multiplier structurally guarantees a contraction will be large enough to cross that threshold. It's an elegant mathematical structure, I'll give you that, but it's one that feels carefully calibrated to produce the desired result of actual saving failure. It feels like a proof of the model's power, perhaps more than a proof of the paradox in all possible economic structures.
Okay, let's move to point three then, the interpretation of the numerical verification itself. I mean, the objective proof is 188, dropping to 157. This quantitative failure is the objective final step. The fact that we start with S equals 188, we introduce a planned behavioral change that promotes thrift, and we conclude with S equals 157, that's the core result. It's verifiable arithmetic, derived directly from the mathematical structure. It forces us to accept that the collective consequence is the opposite of the individual intent.
That's a compelling argument for the power of calculation, but we have to consider the definitional bounds of that verification. We must acknowledge that the proof is entirely predicated on a closed model where output is exclusively demand determined and prices are static. This simple Keynesian framework, well, it assumes away nearly all self-correcting mechanisms.
We did establish the parameters of the model initially. This model is specifically designed to illustrate the paradox of thrift in a rigid demand-constrained environment.
And in that rigid, fixed price environment, the numbers 188 and 157 are powerful results, yes, but they confirm the paradox only within these really restrictive theoretical boundaries. If we introduce flexible prices, or an open economy where exports could absorb the reduced domestic demand, or even interest rate adjustments that might stimulate investment when saving increases, that final actual saving figure of 157 could easily be reversed or at least mitigated. The calculation proves fragility under very specific, limited conditions.
But the initial condition of the model, Y equals 920 versus a full employment Y of 1200, that's the most crucial contextual element. We are demonstrating a market failure that occurs when resources are slack.
The result is a stern warning against austerity when you're facing an output gap. The reduction in saving from 188 to 157 is the calculation that justifies that core Keynesian concern.
It's the calculation that justifies the concern if we assume the investment equation is perfectly responsive to output and the price mechanism is entirely dormant. I just find it intellectually unsatisfying to call this a universally robust proof when we had to fine-tune the engine so aggressively with that 0.15 MPI to ensure the scale of contraction was sufficient. We have to be cautious not to confuse a powerful theoretical demonstration with a general economic law.
In the end, the fact remains that within the constraints of the model, which is a reasonable, below full employment setup, the intended action failed because of the inescapable logic of the multiplier effect. The mechanism of income collapse is undeniably present, and the calculation confirms its overwhelming force. This is a deterministic outcome showing that individual rationality can lead to collective irrationality when demand is depressed.
I suppose I just come at it from a different way. While the calculation proves the paradox for this specific setup, showing that quantitative failure from 188 to 157, the true lesson for me is the extreme sensitivity of equilibrium to these key parameters. The dependence on the high initial MPC and that positive MPI of 0.15 just means the negative output effect was mathematically guaranteed to outweigh the desired increase in thrift. The exercise illuminates how fragile equilibrium can be when structural parameters align in an unfavorable way.
So we have demonstrated how a shift in planned behavior leads to unexpected collective consequences. And we've shown the definitive calculation that proves the paradox of thrift exists within this structured model.
And we've highlighted the importance of scrutinizing the structural assumptions that determine the magnitude of that negative multiplier effect, asking whether the calculation proves the paradox itself or, well, merely the effectiveness of the model's design in maximizing that very effect.
There absolutely remains more to explore in how different structural assumptions, like introducing a foreign sector or flexible interest rates, might modify or even negate the severity of this calculated outcome. But for today, we have rigorously examined how arithmetic confirms a core economic paradox under demand-constrained conditions.